Well, good morning, everyone. How's everybody doing today? Now, we are all here to have a heart-to-heart talk with Governor Corbett, aren't we? Yes. We're here to tell him and talk to him about our concerns and let him hear that we are concerned about the services that everyone here today so rightly deserves. Special education, education transition services, intermediate units. Now, I don't know what the governor was thinking about when he came up with his budget, but I'll tell you what we'd like him to think about here today. We want him to think about the strides that we've made in helping people with autism and intellectual disabilities make it in today's world. We want him to think about how much we've raised awareness by helping those with autism and intellectual disabilities be mainstreamed in school and in the workplace. And we want him to think about everyone in this rotunda personally touched by autism and intellectual disabilities. And this is personal for me, too. This is a friend of mine. This is John Michael Gelati, and this is his dad right in the middle. Let me tell you about John Michael. He's 14 years old. He has autism. He lives in my district. Now, when he was a toddler, he was fascinated with, of all things, toilets. Now, his parents used this interest to interact with him. They helped him learn about the functioning aspects of toilets and their associated flush valve systems. So last spring, John Michael's dad contacted American Standard, which is a major bathroom fixture company in New Jersey, and he told them about John Michael. Well, American Standard invited John Michael and his dad for an exclusive tour of their facility in New Jersey. So John Michael and his dad went out. The company was so impressed, not with how much John Michael knew about their products, but about how much he knew about the competitors' products. So they asked him to pick out a toilet that he could take home. Well, a few months later, John Michael and his dad were at a local park in their town. John Michael had to go to the restroom. He came out and he said to his dad that they had a talk with their friends at American Standard because the toilets in the park were in such awful shape they had to get replaced. So John Michael's dad thinking, well, you know, I'll give it a shot and we'll see what happens. Well, lo and behold, American Standard responds. So they worked with the mayor of John Michael's community. John Michael figured out, he came up with a plan as to what was needed. They told American Standard, and the company approved the list and agreed to donate $4,000 worth of bathroom fixtures for the park. So now city officials have agreed to work on an additional $6,000 so that John Michael's project can go to the next level, and they will do the entire bathrooms over in this community park. So now, what happens? This project helps John Michael learn how to recognize a problem, set goals, and work with other people to reach them. And it's also helping the community by improving the facility at a favorite public park. So now, how can our governor say that people like John Michael don't deserve the funding and deserve adequate funding? People are worth it. So let's be heard by Governor Corbett today. Let's tell him that we value all children and adults with intellectual disabilities as fully participating members of our society. So, Governor Corbett, we're talking to you. Show us the adequate money that helps these people with intellectual disabilities and autism to be fully participating members of our society. Thank you very much, and God bless you.
I happen to know firsthand the important work that these services do. I'm very privileged, along with Denny O'Brien, we have special people in the Northeast, SPIN. Located in our neighborhood there in Northeast Philadelphia. And I can tell you one brief story on how they actually influenced the legislative process. Just last fall, last October, Denny, Tom Mert, and I were there at their annual voting forum. And in the question and answer segment, a member of SPIN raised his hand and spoke eloquently about how harmful the R word is to him, and that he would like I had already known this. My wife, who is a public school teacher nearby in Lower Moreland, and who deals with a number of kids who are on the autistic spectrum, the R word is a pet peeve of hers. So I had already heard that from one person, but hearing it from someone in the intellectual disabilities community was powerful. And I stood up and I committed to him. I said, you know what? I agree with you. There should be a law that encourages people to get away from the R word, and that when I go back in the legislature in January, I'll introduce a bill on that. Well, I'm proud that this January I did exactly that and sponsored a bill that will remove the R word. And so the folks at SPIN should know that you affected the process. Denny and Tom are my lead co-sponsors on it. And together, the three of us will continue pushing that through the legislature. So you've made a difference in one area. Continue to make a difference, because we need to hear your voice, especially in these next 2 months. Tom talked about his anxiety on the upcoming budget. I happen to agree. I share his anxiety. We need to ensure that our budget is not balanced on the backs of those who can afford it least. The fact is, the signs here are right. People are worth it. People are worth it. It has been shown and proven time and time again that invest and grow is always a better strategy for our future rather than slash and burn. So let's stand together. Let's continue to fight. Let's together ensure that our budget reflects the values and morals and priorities of a good society. Thank you.
As you see the signs behind me, you see signs like, my dreams matter, and they do. And my life matters, and it does. And it's imperative that we see those signs, and more importantly, that we see the faces behind those signs as we deal with issues like addressing the waiting list, dealing with the Human Services Development Fund, making sure that the budget funds properly community services for these folks. As Senator Blake mentioned, the cost of institutional care is so much more, and the cost of providing care in the community is so much less, and the quality of life is so much more. And so as we deal with this budget, and as everyone has mentioned, there are competing interests and great needs and resources that are thin, we have to remember the people that spoke here with passion, the faces holding those signs and the messages on those signs, because as we treat this community of our fellow citizens, if we treat them fairly, as we should, then we recognize that all life is inherently valuable. None of us is valued more or less than any other of us. And so it is imperative in this budget process, as we meet these challenges, that we recognize that and we remember the faces. Thank you very much.